Good morning and welcome to Holy Cross. I'm Deacon Nick Rasmussen. Our celebrant this morning is Father Tony Akay, and we have a couple of announcements. First, Mass of Christian Burial was held this week for parishioner Norma Bagley and Eleanor Forrell, mother and mother-in-law of parishioners Judy and Roger Elliott. Please keep them and their families in your prayers. And just a reminder that Our Lady of Lourdes, well, this probably won't do any good because you're not going to have time to get down there. They're having a pancake breakfast, but it's over at noon. So our Mass will begin shortly. Thank you.
Please join in our opening hymn, number 316, as we gather at your table, number 316.
Sacramental In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy. You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of the Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, his Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "See, I am now establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, all the birds and the various tame and wild animals that were with you and came out of the ark. I will establish my covenant with you that never again shall all bodily creatures be destroyed by the waters of a flood. There shall not be another flood to devastate the earth." God added, "This is the sign that I am giving for all ages to come, of the covenant between me and you and every living creature with you. I set my bow in the clouds to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow appears in the clouds, I will recall the covenant I have made between me and you and all living beings, so that the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all mortal beings." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to
truth to those who keep your covenant.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, Christ suffered for sins once, the righteous for the sake of the unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. In it, he also went to preach to the spirits in prison who had once been disobedient, while God patiently waited in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved through water. This prefigured baptism, which saves you now. It is not a removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. After John had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The gospel of the Lord.
It is very typical of the Lenten season for the first Sunday to begin with the notion of temptation. We are in a cycle in which the gospel according to Mark is read. And at times it's a struggle getting the point Mark is making because He's like in a haste. He's rushing to Calvary. And so when we look for details and chronology and all those stuff, the spices and the juices that are gonna make us get easily what he's saying, we might not find them. I'm saying this because look at the gospel reading. He talks about the temptation of Jesus Christ. All we have is just one or two sentences. The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. Excuse me, what is he saying? Where is the pinnacle of the temple? Where is turned bread into stone into bread? Where is fall down and worship me?
all these spices are missing out in Mark. But does Mark actually have a strong message to give us? Absolutely. There is need for us to reflect more. Because even in this short, just two sentences, he has all to tell us about human temptation, who could be tempted, where someone could be tempted, how we can stand temptation, and a lot more. And so there is need for us to pay attention to his choice of vocabularies in order for us to make sense out of what he is saying. Look at what, of course, the precedent is that Jesus was baptized. And typical of Mark, to emphasize the urgency, some translations would say, immediately, right away, the Spirit drove him out into the desert. Where? Into the desert. What does the notion of desert say? A place of fun, right? Like the Disney World. No. He chose that word desert for a specific purpose. It is the universe in life. And why is he talking about immediately, right away? He's talking about the schedule for temptation. Immediately. Right away he was baptized, right away he was taken into the world, right away temptation. And so when is the schedule for temptation? Has anybody ever here scheduled the date, the time, and the place you're going to be tempted? I wish I could do that. Because, he says, the world, the universe is like a desert. And when you are in the desert and you are going there for comfort, wrong place. And so you have to be armed. You have to be ready. You have to be prepared. And he says even, you are not actually doing it all by yourself alone. Who are the people with you there? The grace of God is with you. And that's why we hear him say, and the angels ministered to him. The angels ministered to him. Where were the angels ministering to him? What kind of people what kind of things were with him? Mark tells us in one short phrase, in the desert, Jesus was among wild beasts. It's not the pets in the house. Wild beasts. To denote, it is a struggle. It is a place you have to watch every second. But you are not alone. The angels ministered to him. But then, who could be tempted? He gives us even an extreme example. An extreme example. A whole Son of God, a whole God himself, a whole God whose Holy Spirit just descended upon, and from heaven God was shouting, "This is my beloved with whom I am well pleased." That's the one who is tempted right away. And so he's saying, who is exempt from temptation if Jesus Christ wasn't exempt? even when he just received the Holy Spirit. And so, my dear friends in Christ, as we begin the Lenten season, we are reminded of one. Who are we? Humans. Human beings. And where are we in the world? In order that we don't fall asleep about that, Mark says it's a desert. And who are our neighbors? Wild bees. But how do we navigate? The angels ministered to him. The grace of God is with us. God is with us. In every situation in life, from the very beginning, all the time. But we have got to do our own part. And that's the place of the Lenten season. And so, my dear friends in Christ, there is need for us to keep in mind always that temptation does not run on our own schedules. It runs on its own schedules. In many cases, it comes even like a pop-up. You say you don't want to face temptation. Okay, you just stay in your house. Okay, let me just turn on my TV. Yeah, you're going to know what you're going to see on the TV. Before you click the next, oh, no, I can't see this. Before you close your, oh, it's too late. It doesn't run on our own schedule. Instead, we are called to recognize who we are. We are mere human beings who face temptations in life. The Lenten season itself is an opportunity for us to reflect on our own weaknesses and to do something to strengthen ourselves, because God gives us strength. The angels ministered to him. Jesus is proclaiming the kingdom. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. But how do we go about that? Like Jesus, by prayer, by almsgiving, by fasting, by a combo of these. That is how we help ourselves against temptation. Also, we have to pay attention to what God is saying. And so, by focusing on God's word and his direction, these are ways we live in this desert referred to as the world.
Remain seated.
Reverend Father, these catechumens whom I now present to you are beginning their final period of preparation and purification leading to their initiation. They have found strength in God's grace and support in our community prayers and example. Now they ask that they be recognized for the progress they have made in their spiritual formation, and they receive the assurance of our blessings and prayers as they go forth to the rite of election celebrated this afternoon by Archbishop Lucas. Those who are to be sent to the celebration of the election in Christ, come forward together with those that will be your sponsors. Deb Serco, Kara Bowen, Sherry Bonson, and Ryan Connor. Come forward, please.
My dear friends, these catechumens who have been prepared for the sacraments of initiation hope that they will be found ready to participate in the rite of election and be chosen in Christ for the Easter sacraments. It is the responsibility of this community to inquire about their readiness before they are presented to the bishop. Godparents, I turn to you, godparents, for your testimony about these candidates. Have these candidates taken their formation in the gospel and the Catholic way of life seriously? Have they given evidence of their conversion by the example of their lives? Do you judge them to be ready to be presented to the bishop for the rite of election? Now, my dear catechumens, this community gladly recommends you to the bishop, who in the name of Christ will call you to the Easter sacraments. May God bring to completion the good work he has begun in you. May we now all join in prayer. May we stand. My dear brothers and sisters, we look forward to the celebration at Easter, the life-giving mysteries of our Lord's suffering, death, and resurrection. As we journey together to the Easter sacraments, these catechumens will look to us for example of Christian renewal. Let us therefore pray to the Lord for them and for ourselves, that we may be renewed by one another's efforts, together come to share the joys of Easter.
That these catechumens may be freed from selfishness and learn to put others first, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
that their godparents may be living examples of the gospel, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That their teachers may always convey to them the beauty of God's word, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That these catechumens may share with others the joy they have found in their friendship with Jesus, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our community during this Lenten season may grow in charity and be constant in prayer, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we pray that all baptized Christians faithfully proclaim the reign of God and turn to him in every temptation, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That political leaders avoid temptations of power and greed and serve with sincere generosity those they represent, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who face obstacles, be they physical or emotional, grow in faith-filled stamina and determination, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are homeless, that they can find food and shelter, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of this assembly, in prayer and fasting, be drawn ever more deeply into the Paschal mystery, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our own personal intentions and for those who have died, especially Norma Begley, that God will bring them and all the faithfully departed into his presence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Zach Luther and Mary Wilderding, for whom this Mass is celebrated, we pray to the Lord.
Lord,
Father of love and power, it is your will to establish everything in Christ and to draw us into his all-embracing love. Guide these catechumens in the days and weeks ahead. Strengthen them in their vocation. Build them into the kingdom of your Son and seal them with the Holy Spirit of your promise. We make all these our prayers to Jesus Christ our Lord. My dear friends, you are about to set out on the road that leads to the glory of Easter. Christ will be your way, your truth, and your life. In his name, we send you forth from this community to celebrate with the bishop the Lord's choice of you to be numbered among his elect, and we may meet again for his scrutinies. Walk always in his peace. Go in peace, and may the Lord remain with you always. Thanks be to God. May we now sit down for the offertory collection.
Please join us in singing number 440, You Are Near, number 440.
Thank you.
brethren, that mine and your sacrifice may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty. Give us the right dispositions, O Lord, we pray, to make these offerings. For with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrated through his fast the pattern of our Lenten observance, and by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, he taught us to cast out the leaven of malice so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mysteries, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, our spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and George our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And with your
spirit. Now offer one another a sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worried that you should enter the Lamb. But only say the word.
Our communion hymn is number 328, Bread of Life, number 328.
Lead us to one.
Please join in the prayer after Holy Communion that may be found on the blue cards in the pew. Soul of Christ, sanctify me. Body of Christ, save me. Blood of Christ, inebriate me. Water from the side of Christ, wash me. Passion of Christ, strengthen me. O good Jesus, hear me. Within your wounds, hide me. Never let me be separated from you. From the evil one, protect me. At the hour of my death, call me and bid me to come to thee, that with your saints I may praise you forever and ever. Amen. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine. O sacrament most holy, O sacrament divine, all praise and all thanksgiving be every moment thine.
Let us pray. Renew now with heavenly bread, by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened, we pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. Thank you, Father Tony. My name is Shannon Brummer, and I am the Executive Director for the Omaha Catholic School Consortium. I'm grateful for the chance to be with you to tell you a bit about the consortium, but mostly to thank you for your investment and the part you are playing to ensure Catholic education is a vibrant opportunity for the children in our neighborhoods to grow in their faith and in their potential. Holy Cross Parish is one of 16 parishes coming together to support six Catholic elementary schools in Southeast Omaha. You have supported your Catholic school for nearly 90 years, but your investment has broadened in a profound way. Not only are you impacting the 288 students here at Holy Cross, but 1,654 students across South Omaha. Your school and parish are part of an exciting and important collaborative called the Omaha Catholic School Consortium. Why this change from the traditional parish school model? We all know the demographics in our area had been shifting. Mass attendance was decreasing, school enrollment was declining, and the burden individual parishes carried to maintain their schools was becoming close to impossible. So something had to change. In 2011, Archbishop Lucas made a promise to those of us living east of 72nd Street. His commitment to Catholic education came with his ongoing support and prayers and nearly $8 million from the Ignite the Faith campaign and other archdiocesan resources to secure this new collaboration. Eight schools in Southeast Omaha merged into five: Holy Cross, St. Thomas More, Our Lady of Lourdes, Saints Peter and Paul, St. Bernadette, along with the Dual Language Academy at St. Joan of Arc, make up the schools of the consortium today. We are 10 years into this innovative model and still have room to grow, but we can celebrate the impact on our students, schools, and families. And we can all be proud of what we have done together. The consortium is a model that unites our six schools and allows them to share resources and expertise. This means that teachers can work more efficiently and effectively toward their common goal of providing high-quality Catholic education to our students. Collaboration has led to aligning more curriculum and materials across the schools. Recently, we implemented new math, science, language arts, and social studies curriculum, resulting in improved test scores and expanded student engagement. I hear parents voice appreciation for enhancements such as the Arupe math program for advanced learners, which would not have been possible in a singular school, and for collaborative efforts like the Our Lady of Lourdes and Holy Cross eighth graders joining for a beautiful candlelit night of reflection. I hear our principals and staff praise this collaborative model that benefits them professionally, spiritually, and personally as they work and grow together. They feel supported, they feel encouraged and inspired. They know this level of collaboration is unique and not possible at a traditional parish school, and this is impacting our schools and students. And I hear students express their appreciation. Maggie Naughton, a Holy Cross graduate and a freshman at Mercy High School, says she was fully prepared for high school academically, but also with time management skills and the confidence to get involved. She even started Mercy's new writing club, all because of the encouragement of her Holy Cross teachers and classmates. Maggie also appreciated the opportunities to grow in her faith, especially to be involved in the Holy Cross class masses, where she learned to pay attention to the readings and hear what God was saying to her. You are standing with the 1,654 consortium students like Maggie, 3 out of 4 of whom live right here in Southeast Omaha. More than half come from racially diverse backgrounds, and half qualify for free and reduced lunch. 86% are Catholic. 3 out of 5 of our eighth graders go on to Catholic high school, which nearly ensures them of graduating from high school and moving on to the next level of education or career opportunity. Each year, non-Catholic students and families ask how to become Catholic. A decade ago, Archbishop Lucas made us a promise, and I am here to further that promise to ensure the consortium is financially strong, that our academic programs are unsurpassed, that we stimulate our parish partnerships and enhance student, school, and family collaboration. We increase enrollment and tuition assistance so more students and families have the great gift of a Catholic education, and every student comes to know Jesus' love in a personal and beautiful way. Thank you to each member of Holy Cross Parish. You are investing in these 1,654 students, in their faith, in their families, in your parish, in our neighborhoods, and in the South Omaha community and beyond. I pray you leave today knowing how grateful that we are. You are on the journey with us. There are cards in the pews with more information about the consortium and a link for even more. And I'll be here after Mass along with Holy Cross Principal Mr. James LaVille, and we look forward to connecting with you. Again, thank you and God bless you.
I want to use this opportunity on behalf of the pastor and the staff to thank each and every one of you for your wonderful participation at our Eucharistic celebration. Unfortunately, it's over 1 hour. It's 12:04. So my agreement with the deacon is that if we go over 1 hour, that's his fault. May we stand for the blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
May bountiful blessing, O Lord, we pray, come down upon your people, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God bless and keep you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
We will close with number 128, Led by the Spirit. Number 128.